Some announcements, mainly just please be on time for the blog posts and follow-ups. Also, please try to be on time for the report. But for the blog posts, we have a bit of a tighter schedule because I wanted to get them done before the weekend that you're probably going to be spending working on the report. So that you have sort of a full opportunity to get all of the practice you would need for the papers and for analyzing papers to help you with the report. We'll get some feedback to you as well by Thursday or Friday of that week about the blog post and the recap, which hopefully will be helpful for you as you are figuring out how to write up the what amounts to really a very long blog post about the article you've chosen for your report. So again, for this unit, we're talking about the motor system, and this ties together a lot of different concepts from throughout the course, and I'll kind of continue to point those out along the way as we get to them. It also draws from material from five different chapters of the book, I have a different organization than the book does for how I present it, so you get to jump around a little bit with that. Today, we're going to talk about actually a little bit of an adjustment since we were sort of right in the middle of talking about the spinal cord and reflexes in the spinal cord and other kinds of control of movement that the spinal cord can do on its own when class time ended last time. Rather than jumping all the way up to the brain and talking about the basal ganglia, I want to actually finish up with the spinal cord material. And that includes bringing in something that that ended up getting put off from Unit 3 anyway, which is proprioception, which is in many ways similar to somatosensation, but is also much more intimately tied to motor systems than it is to somatosensation, at least in how your brain uses it. There is a perceptual aspect to proprioception. So proprioception, again, is knowing where your arms and legs are in space, where your different body parts are relative to one another. And the fact that with my eyes closed, if I fall asleep and then my arm ends up here, assuming it doesn't fall asleep, doesn't start tingling and whatever, then when I wake up, I don't need to look to see where my hand is. I just know right where it is. And so that is definitely a sensory experience. The fact that I know where my limbs are is a sensory fact, but it's very tightly tied in with our motor systems and motor control. So we're going to talk about that. We will hopefully begin to discuss a little bit about the basal ganglia, which was the scheduled topic for today, and that's certainly going to continue on into next Tuesday. And then next Thursday, I think the plan is to talk about the cerebellum and other sort of subcortical brain circuits involved in motor control and regulation of motor systems. And then from there, we're going to continue on and talk about various other types of high-level motor output, and also some simpler circuits involved in vestibular sense, which is in some senses similar to proprioception, but it's more your sense of gravity. So if I'm tilting my head back, then I know gravity's down, and there are sensors in my inner ear that allow me to do that. If my body's accelerating or my head's accelerating and spinning, then there's fluid that moves around in my ears that lets me know that my head is moving or my body's accelerating. And you know, like my five-year-old likes spinning himself around and getting himself dizzy, that's taking advantage of his vestibular sense. And then we'll talk also about eye movements, which is something that we did on the very, very first day of class, and also ties in again with motor and sensory inputs. Oops. Okay. But before we do that, somebody asked think, was it Neela who asked the other day about what happens with new muscle growth? When you grow new muscles, how do they get nerves connected? Was that, that wasn't you? Okay, sorry. I'm misremembering who. But somebody asked, how do you know which motor, which muscle gets connected to? Sorry to whoever I'm forgetting who asks this. And so I looked for a little while to figure out what's known about when a new muscle fiber grows, how it gets innervated. One thing that is well established is just like muscle fibers that grow early in life, the new muscle fibers only have one neuron providing input, and that neuron is not a brand new neuron, but it's a neuron that was already controlling several other muscle fibers, and so now this one neuron has a larger motor unit, meaning that there are more muscle fibers that it connects to. I mentioned a little bit, and we didn't go into a lot of detail about it, but if you take general physiology, who's taking physiology for, do they talk about slow twitch and fast twitch muscles in that class? Red and white muscle? Okay, yeah. So most motor neurons, and there's actually like more than just slow twitch and fast twitch, there's like intermediate, there's like a bunch of different kinds. But anyway, most motor neurons will either innervate mostly or entirely slow twitch muscles or mostly or entirely fast twitch muscles. And so this new muscle fiber that's grown is, if it's a slow twitch fiber, is going to get input probably from a motor neuron that also innervates other slow twitch fibers. That's not something that you need to worry about for this class. One thing that I did find out is that there are some research which has shown that muscle fibers that develop older in life start to release what are called neurotrophic factors. And anyone who's taken neurobiology of disease with me hopefully remembers brain-derived neurotrophic factor, or BDNF, which is one of the signals that your neurons use to communicate with each other and help to maintain synaptic connections. Neurotrophic factors can also be used to grow new synaptic connections and encourage neurons to grow new branches to their axons or grow new extensions on their dendrites. And so the new muscle fiber will release something called neurotrophin 4, which is another neurotrophic factor similar to BDNF, that encourages, like, hey, I'm here, I need a motor neuron to innervate me. It encourages motor neurons to send branches. What I wasn't able to find out is whether, like in embryonic development, whether multiple motor neurons innervate this new muscle fiber initially and then they compete with each other to see who wins out, or whether one just lands and stays there. This paper was published now 15 or 20 years ago, this one that I'm putting the abstract up here from. And the follow-up work that cites it, when I read through and sort of looked through all of the follow-up research that cites it, is mostly interested in various disease states like ALS, and muscular dystrophy, or using what's known from this study involving adult new muscle fibers to understand something more about embryonic development. So as far as I can tell, there's very, very little research done on that one particular question. To me, it seemed like an interesting question and potentially worthy of more research, even though it may not have as many direct clinical applications as something like ALS or something else. It's one of these things where when I find something that we don't have a good solid understanding of, it always kind of surprises me the gaps in our knowledge. And as near as I can tell, that question about whether a new muscle fiber, how a new muscle fiber gets its motor neuron input, seems to be something that's really poorly studied. Any questions about that? I may not have answers because, as far as I can tell, there's not much known. But So like I said a couple minutes ago, we've already talked about motor cortex. Don't worry, I'll turn those back on so fewer people fall asleep, because I know everyone's up late with build week and everything. So we've already talked about motor cortex and a general introduction to motor units and spinal cord. Today we're going to be talking about proprioception, reflexes, and other spinal control. Hopefully get into a little bit of an introduction of the basal ganglia. But a week from today, after Carnival, that's when we're going to go in more detail about the basal ganglia. That is the day. So the original post is actually due tomorrow. The response is going to be due a week from today. And then on Thursday of next week, we'll talk about the cerebellum, which is another subcortical structure. It's actually visible on the surface of the brain. It's this extra wrinkly zone here, but it's not part of the cerebral cortex. It's actually more officially part of the brainstem. But it provides a lot of input and coordination for movement as well. I mentioned briefly last time that initiation of movement is mostly the job of the basal ganglia, and the basal ganglia mostly gets activated when movements start, and then the job of the cerebellum is to keep you from tripping while you're in the middle of doing some ongoing sequence of movements. And then from that, the cerebellar information actually leads into a discussion of vestibular sense, which is, again, your sense of balance, and the ability to coordinate movements and complicated things like running or dancing or whatever requires both your cerebellum to keep you from making mistakes and your sense of balance to keep you sort of upright while you're doing these things. And in addition to the vestibular sense and its role in like whole body movements and keeping you from falling over, the vestibular sense also has some impacts on eye movement. And so we'll talk about that as well as the control of eye movements in sort of the visual motor system. On Tuesday the 2nd, and then for the last day of class, we'll be talking about things that relate to the blog post that you're doing, which is reproductive behaviors, and sort of a general recap of motivated behaviors, which is one of the topics in I think chapter 15 of the book, and that ties back into things like the basal ganglia, which we'll introduce a little today and more next week. Yeah. Any questions about upcoming plans? Okay, so for today, we're going to start off with the in-class assignment that we did at the very end of class last time, which is trying to understand spinal control of walking. And this is, as I think everyone sort of got a sense as they were working through these, a complicated question. There are a lot of possible ways, and many groups came up with many different possible ways to create a circuit that, so the goal was to create a circuit that extends my left leg as I'm flexing my right, and then plants and extends my right as I'm flexing my left, and then extends my left as I'm flexing my right. That's what we need to do to walk. We saw earlier on, and so around the middle of the lecture, a circuit within one side of the spinal cord that allows you to alternate between flexing and extending and flexing and extending, which is the one leg problem, but coordinating that across the two legs so that they're working in sync with each other but doing the opposite things involves more regulation. And that's what we're going to, and that was the assignment at the end of class last time. There were, like I said, a lot of different attempts that people made. I'm going to talk about some of the attempts that people made and then talk about one solution that sort of takes advantage of some existing circuitry I think the best hypothesis we have about how this works. I should say that for simpler organisms like leeches and fish, where they swim and there's this alternation pattern across the body with swimming, it's been very well worked out what the circuit is. There are still some unknowns in terms of mammals, how this circuit actually works. But one of the circuits that we looked at with pain reflexes actually provides a nice solid hypothesis for what's going on with this. So just to kind of recap, even without input from the brain, the spinal cord can get some sensory input about the world moving under your feet, and convert that sensory input into a motor output of walking. And within one leg, we had this relatively simple circuit where we have some continuous input coming in. This could be continuous input from the sensory environment in this case, or it could be descending continuous input from the brain. Remember that the brain and the brain stem and the motor cortex send some connections directly to motor neurons, which are these level C cells here. So I can move one muscle at a time. But most of their connections go to controlling neurons, like this neuron A here, that then activate some set of circuits within the spinal cord to make a more complicated movement, in this case, something that requires alternating between two muscle groups. Let me pause there. What questions do people have from last time about sort of the difference between those things? Yeah, sure. Yeah, so a big issue that babies have, I guess there's a couple things. So some things are pre-wired in. Very young newborn babies, we did this with our kids, and now I can't remember what it is. But very new baby, I think if you basically do the treadmill thing, where you suspend them with their feet on the ground and then kind of move their feet, they will walk like that. So that indicates that something like this is already there. The big challenge for a lot, well, there are more complicated things that are learned, like typing and writing and speaking and so on. But the big challenge for young nervous systems ends up being myelination, which is critical for getting everything timed right. My wife's graduate advisor would say of her kid that it was interesting to watch because she could see her child getting myelinated over time. So children become sort of more coordinated and are able to coordinate actions between different sides of their bodies and between their legs and so on, and between their arms. That coordination requires really good precision in timing. And in fact, I mean, there's sort of reasons to know that's true. So if a pitcher is throwing a baseball, to get it into the strike zone, the pitcher needs to release it with, like, I don't know, like 3 millisecond precision or something. And the time it takes an action potential to travel from the even though it's myelinated, even though the axons are myelinated, from the spinal cord to the hand to release that is something like 15 milliseconds or something. And so the motor command to release the ball has already been sent when the pitcher's arm is like halfway through the throw. And so if your myelination is a little bit too light and the motor command travels too slowly, you'll end up throwing the ball to the ground, or end up throwing the ball way up high in the air and releasing it too soon. And so that's a big part of why kids are sort of uncoordinated. And so I think that the answer to this is, for a lot of these relatively simple circuits that have existed for many millions of years of evolution, they are sort of hardwired in, but the timing needs to be learned and also kind of constantly relearned and updated, because as your body grows, that requires you to sort of change a little bit the timing as well. So the timings and sort of the precise details get developed, but I think the underlying circuitry is mostly there. Yeah. Other questions about this? Yeah, sure.
You talked about, like, the atomic input in A, how that from like the sensory environment, you kind of
yes.
the latter.
Yeah, yeah, sure. So this is sort of what's illustrated by this cat on the treadmill, or the picture I had last time by the woman who was paralyzed from the waist down, suspended on a treadmill. If you start kind of falling forward, then your legs will sort of notice the difference in pressure on your feet, I guess, as you're sort of moving forward, and that provides a clue that's available below the waist to that you're off balance, and so that sort of putting a foot in front reflexively is a way to correct that. And so what that means is there's certain types of sensory input that can come from pressure sensitive neurons on your feet that say, okay, we're off balance, and will activate the same neuron that starts off a pattern of walking. It's somewhat analogous to the pain system, similar in some ways, but different in others. And that's actually one of the things we'll be getting to in a couple of minutes, where we're sort of flexing one leg and extending the other, in this case, to get my foot off of the sharp tack that I've stepped on, but very similarly to sort of get my foot in front of me so I don't fall forward. Yeah, other questions about that? Okay, so last time we talked as well about this system of picking your leg up. And in order to pick your leg up, you have an input come in through the ventral part of the spinal cord, or sorry, the dorsal part of the spinal cord, which is where all the inputs come in. And then this pain-sensitive neuron activates several synapses. So in fact, we've already talked about one other synapse that's not shown there that this pain-sensitive neuron activates. So incoming pain, this axon is going to make several branches. And one of those branches is onto an inhibitory neuron. One of those branches is onto a local excitatory neuron. One of those branches is onto an excitatory neuron that's going to project up to your brain, which is not shown here. But that's what tells you, that's how you get the sensation that your foot got hurt. But even before your brain finds out that your foot got hurt, you've already started to make the movement to correct for it. And by the way, these are the A beta fibers of pain, the sort of myelinated pain, so that you can get off the tack in less than a second. And so then this inhibitory neuron is going to make a synaptic connection onto one motor neuron. The excitatory neuron makes a synaptic connection onto the other motor neuron. And so to move my foot, I need to flex my leg, which means contracting my hamstring and relaxing my quadricep. Meanwhile, and here's where things get a little bit more complicated, and I'll redraw them over on the other board in just a second. But meanwhile, there's another branch of this same axon that makes an input onto another neuron, which is called a commissural neuron. Commissural just means it crosses from one side of the brain, one side of the nervous system to the other. So it activates this commissural neuron. And then this commissural neuron makes its own branching inputs onto its own inhibitory neuron and its own excitatory neuron. And then now we need to do the opposite with the other leg to sort of straighten that leg out so that I can bear the extra weight, which means that I need to relax my hamstring and contract my quadricep. And so these last neurons here that connect to the muscle, those are our motor neurons. Everything else is a kind of interneuron, meaning it gets its inputs from other neurons and makes its output to other neurons, I guess with the exception of this, which is a sensory neuron. Okay, so yeah, questions about that reflex pathway. Okay, and so I sort of showed these up together before and asked you to build out of these something that will allow you to have bilateral control of walking. And so I wanted to highlight and sort of show several of the different ideas that are out there. A lot of these ideas would work. Some of them are actually quite possible because, like I said, there are some open questions about how mammals actually do this. But in terms of something that is sort of straightforward and simple, I think that there is a somewhat simpler version, at least once we understand this system, there's a somewhat simpler version that we can use to create this pattern than a lot of groups came up with. And that's, I think, totally understandable since you know, before last Thursday, you hadn't even ever seen this before. And so people were trying to sort of work through it as they were going. So one idea, which is actually not too far off from the way that the way that the system may actually in fact work, is to have some control neuron here that then has inhibition, so similar to this, having inhibition at this next level, and then it controls the two spinal cord, the two sides of the spinal cord with local inhibition between reciprocal inhibition to sort of create a pattern within both of those sides. I think that actually something like this might even be a better depiction in some senses of the one that I'm going to show you in a minute, because one of the ones that I'm going to show you ignores some subtle features about timing of the contractions of the two things. But I think that you can get most of the way there with a slightly simpler circuit than this. So we'll get to that in a minute. This is something, again, very similar. In this case, they have two command neurons on the two sides, and they reciprocally inhibit one another. That actually may be another way to solve this problem as well. But it's sort of very similar, except without the one driver sort of coming in above. There were other versions where there were inhibitory projections at the level of motor neurons. I think this would work, except for the fact that the motor neurons typically just project out of the spinal cord and typically just release acetylcholine, which is mostly just excitatory. Anatomically, I don't think that motor neurons actually connect up with each other across the spinal cord ever. But that's not a fact that I gave you beforehand. And then there were some sort of more complicated circuits, which again might actually be something like what's actually going on, but is I think a little bit more complex than is really necessary to at least capture some of the core features of this. Similarly to these first couple, these first couple might actually be in some senses more accurate than what I'm going to describe, but is I think maybe a little bit more complex than is really necessary. And again, biology has no obligation to be simple, and anyone who's paid attention in this class or taken other classes will recognize that biology is actually very, very rarely simple. But still, we're going to try and sort of come up with a simple solution to this problem, or comparatively simple solution to this problem. There was one other group that began this process and then stop and say, okay, well, during walking, wouldn't one of these B neurons have to always preferentially fire first to initiate the correct rhythm? So the hamstring needs to relax after the quad. How are we going to get this started in the right time to make it so that we've got the two legs synchronized, and to make sure that I don't start off walking by trying to extend my legs, but instead I start off walking by flexing one leg? And so that is a great question, and sort of illustrates, I think, sort of where we were at the end of class last time, and I want to kind of build on where we were to get to a more complete, plausible model here. Okay, so let me grab a few colors here to work with on this. Yeah, any questions about any of that from the activity last time? Okay, so looking at this right here, if we take kind of a version of what's here, here I'll try and be somewhat consistent. So we'll do. I don't need this one. Okay, so we'll make the excitatory neurons here green, and then the inhibitory neurons red and the motor neurons blue to kind of keep some consistency with what's going on. So if we ignore for a second actually the reciprocal inhibition going on in the B layer for a second and just look at the right diagram here. If we have a neuron that this incoming sensory neuron makes essentially three branches, one of which maybe through an intermediate connects up to something that's going to cross the midline, one of which connects up to an excitatory neuron, and one of which connects up to an inhibitory neuron, then our inhibitory neuron can inhibit something, our excitatory neuron can excite, and then we can then create a motor neuron output to the hamstring, and another motor neuron output to the quad. And then, running out of space here, but we have another excitatory neuron that then connects up. Actually, here, we're going to take this connection out for a second. Connects up here to this, and then it connects to an inhibitory neuron that inhibits this, and an excitatory neuron that excites this. And so at this point, with this system, whenever this neuron's going, we're going to be flexing our leg, our hamstring contracts and our quad relaxes. And whenever this neuron goes, we're going to be contracting our leg. So let's call this left. So this is our left flex neuron, and this is our left extend neuron here. And then we just build the same thing on the other side. So we have on the other side so then this neuron is going to cause our hamstring to relax. So this neuron becomes our right flex neuron. Right extend neuron. And then this neuron is our right flex neuron. And so I'm going to draw in the middle, even though this doesn't actually exist in the middle, but I'm going to draw it up here in the middle, what we're going to need then to control this. So here's where we want to put our alternating central pattern generator. And so for that, we're going to have some command neuron A, and this is similar to what a couple people wrote on there. And then our command neuron A is going to connect out to some inhibitory neurons, B1 and B2. And then from here, there's kind of a variety. And then these need to be reciprocally connected to reciprocally inhibit each other. So that's what we had before. This is our one single continuous driving force. Driving input is going to get B1 and B2 to alternate. And so now what we want is whenever we are flexing the left leg, we want to be extending the right. And so what we can do is make it so that whenever we're inhibiting left flexion, we'll also be inhibiting right extension. And then whenever we're inhibiting left extension, we inhibit right flexion. So then what's going to happen is at some point in time, just like we saw back here, B1 is active. And when B1 is active, left flexion and right extension are inhibited. And so left extension and right flexion are activated. And then B1 eventually dies down, B2 becomes active, and now left extension and right flexion are inhibited, so left flexion and right extension become activated. And so that creates this alternation going on here. And so, like I said, because there are a lot of open questions in this, I don't know for sure that this is the only way. And for an exam question, I might ask you to design a circuit that would accomplish a particular task. You should be aware of the circuits that are well mapped out, like this one here, and one of the other ones with reflexes and proprioception that we'll be talking about in a minute, as well as the circuits for eye movement and basal ganglia, which is coming up mostly on Tuesday, some of the cerebellar circuits, and the autonomic nervous system circuits with the sympathetic and parasympathetic system that Dr. Barth talked about. So you should sort of be aware of all of those and be able to draw on them to add some layers of complexity. These answers here, I think all of them would have gotten full credit or very close to full credit. And like I said, some of them with inhibition at multiple layers are in a sense more complicated than what I did and may even be more accurate, but maybe a little bit more complicated than what's really needed. But again, the final exam is open notes and open book and everything. So if I ask you to sort of illustrate and draw out a circuit that might potentially accomplish some task, you should be able to, you will be able to draw on all of what we've done. Go to the video and copy this down. At the end of class, I'll zoom in on this to make sure that everyone can see a good image of it and everything. So you should be able to do those. And there's not necessarily going to be one right answer. If I say, okay, we need to accomplish this task, you help me figure out a neural circuit that's going to do it. But being able to sort of understand how these connections work together is kind of the main goal, and how you can create these complex behaviors with, you know, what do we have there, 10 neurons, something like that, relatively simple neural circuit. So what questions do people have about that? Sort of finishing up from the spinal cord central pattern stuff from last time. So, like I said, these answers are not necessarily wrong. They're in fact maybe even more right than what I've written here. But one of the reasons why I sort of chose this example is because it's sort of who's taken like concepts in math or something? So if you're in math and you've proven something and you go through this really long proof of something, and then the next proof you need to do There's maybe an easy way to do it. So this is the joke about mathematicians is if you're trying to boil a pot of water, right? You give a physicist and a mathematician a cold pot, and you tell them to boil the water. And so they put the pot on the stove, turn on the stove, and wait for a while, and the water boils. Then you give the physicist and the mathematician a hot pot of water. And the physicist puts the hot pot on the stove, turns it on, and it boils. The mathematician dumps out the hot water, fills it up with cold water, and says, okay, now it's the same as the old problem that I've already solved. And so that's sort of the approach here, is we've already solved a way to contract flex one leg while we extend the other. And so let's take advantage of what we've built here to alternate between flexion and extension on one leg versus the other. Okay, so what questions do people have about that? Okay, so next topic for today is proprioception, reflexes, and actually a little bit of a return to some of the physics that was briefly introduced on a quiz way back at the beginning. But before we get into that, I just want to remind you about the three types of touch sensors that we've already talked about. There's the unmyelinated pain axons that are very narrow and unmyelinated and very slow to conduct action potentials. Remember, speed is as the axon gets thicker and more myelinated, the speed of conduction goes faster. So you have a lot of these pain and temperature itch fibers that are unmyelinated and don't conduct action potentials to your central nervous system very quickly. There are also myelinated pain and temperature fibers called the A-delta fibers, and that's so if you touch a hot stove and reflexively pull away, or step on a hot or a sharp object and reflexively do this, extend one leg and contract the other, that you can have those happen in less than a second. So this is sort of carrying the sharp pain and some of the most extreme temperature sensations. Then there's also the sensory endings that we've talked about. So we talked about different types of sensory endings, the hair follicles, the four kinds of skin sensors, and then also free nerve endings, which are the ones that carry a lot of the pain information. The four kinds of touch sensors plus the hair follicles all travel along what are called A-beta fibers. There's also anybody who knows the Greek alphabet knows that we're missing a letter in here between A-beta and A-delta. The A-gamma fibers are a type of motor neuron, but they're not. So these were classified before people knew which axons were sending information out and which axons were bringing information in. And so they got their designations based on whether they're myelinated or not, and then how thickly they're myelinated. There's one other type of axon that's not plotted on this graph, but actually makes up a pretty substantial fraction of the axons that are bringing in information from the periphery. And these are the A-alpha fibers. And these are the proprioceptive fibers. So we've got the same sort of three that we just talked about. The A-gammas, which are motor fibers, would be in between the betas and deltas. And there are two types of proprioceptive fibers that give you information about your muscles and your joints. So with proprioception, our two sensors are what are called muscle spindle fibers. And Golgi tendon organs. And the book has a sort of a reconstruction of Golgi tendon organs. So muscles connect to bones at tendons. And these Golgi tendon organs are sensing, so these are sensing essentially your joints and your muscle and something about muscle strain. So they're sort of, they're sensitive to joints, including joint angle and pressure on your joints. And then your muscle spindle fibers send information about how tight your muscles are. So in a muscle that connects one bone to another bone, here, let me make this slightly less ridiculous looking. So here's maybe our forearm, and then here's maybe our, or actually, let's make this the the radius and ulna. So this, this forearm here. From here, and then this is the humerus, which is this part of my arm here. So we have muscle, and then we have tendon. And the muscle sort of narrows into a tendon. And so then when I contract my muscle, I can shorten this distance, which means that the way to shorten this distance is to pull the radius closer. And then there's a counteracting force where my humerus pushes my radius out at this point. So I have to pull in here, push out there. And so what happens is I get a torque and my arm moves. Okay, so and so what we've got here is take advantage of some color again. So inside, deep within the muscle, is we have our muscle spindle fibers, which wrap around some of the motor, some of the muscle cells, some of the muscle fibers, and sense how tight they are. We also have here in our tendons our Golgi tendon organ, which is providing information about how tight the tendon is, and also the joint. So if I want to know where my body, where my limbs are in space, if I know the angle of all of my joints and the tightness of all of my muscles, then it is in principle possible to figure out where every limb is in space. And in fact, your brain dedicates a lot of your cerebellum and other parts of your brain to figuring out where things are in space based on the tension on these different inputs. But these are the sensations coming in that that tell you this. These are the fastest and most heavily myelinated axons, definitely in your peripheral nervous system, possibly anywhere in your body. As far as I know, anywhere in your body. These are the fastest, most heavily myelinated axons that we've got. So this all comes into our spinal cord. Actually, sorry, before I dive into the spinal cord, what questions do people have about this here? Okay, so this information comes into the spinal cord, and first we're going to sort of track what happens with the muscle spindle fibers. So our muscle spindle fibers make excitatory projections. One branch goes up to your brain, which is going to go to your cerebellum and your VPL, which is the part of your thalamus that connects up to your somatosensory cortex for everything below your neck. There's going to be a couple synapses between here and there, but that's eventually where that information is going. So you know where your body is, and you can use that information to coordinate your movements. In addition to that, this axon makes a long excitatory, relatively long excitatory projection onto a motor neuron that is then going to come back and excite this muscle. And then in addition to that, it makes a connection onto an inhibitory neuron that is going to inhibit the motor neuron for, in this case, the other muscle, which is our triceps. So this would be our biceps muscle. That would be our triceps muscle. So and we'll talk about in a second what that means, but essentially what that means is if my biceps muscle gets stretched, these are stretch activated, so actually let's take 3 minutes and kind of do this as a group. So if my biceps muscle gets stretched, what's going to happen in terms of all of these different neurons? So what's going to happen to this one? What's going to happen to this one? What's going to happen to this one? And what's going to happen to my biceps muscle and triceps muscle? So let's just take 3 minutes, talk to your neighbors, and try and figure that out. Okay, so this slide that's up here shows what's essentially the exact same circuit with different colors. Their inhibitory neuron is purple, and then they've got all different colors for the excitatory neurons instead of just the green that I use. But it's essentially the same thing. This is when you go to the doctor and they hit your leg with a hammer. What the hammer does is it pulls on the tendons, which stretches the quad muscle. And so we've got a stretch in our quad muscle. This is going to cause this sensory neuron that comes from the muscle stretch receptor to become active, start firing action potentials. And so this is going to come in here, and then what happens, let's say, first of all, to this motor neuron that it makes a direct connection onto? Excite it, inhibit it. I heard whispers of excite. Yeah, so we excite this motor neuron. And so we're going to very quickly, this is the fastest reflex you have. If you remember back here, pain, we did not have a direct connection from pain axons to the motor neurons. We had to go through an intermediate excitatory neuron for this. Whereas for this here, there's no intermediate excitatory neuron. Direct sensory input to motor neuron output. This is, as far as I know, the only place in the mammalian body where you have sensors directly exciting motor neurons. And so this is going to contract the muscle, right? And so in a sense, what's happened is the muscle got stretched, so we contract it. It's fixing the problem. The problem is there's this unexpected stretch, so we want to correct that. In fact, your muscle didn't really move. The doctor sort of tricked your muscle into thinking it moved by pulling on it in just the right way with the hammer. But that's what happened there. Okay, so what about this inhibitory neuron here? What happens to it? It gets excited. So then what happens to the motor neuron that it connects to? Get inhibited. So now our hamstring muscle is going to relax. Or in this example, the triceps muscle is going to relax. And so if we relax this one and contract this one, then we kick out. And so that's why you kick the doctor when you do that. If anybody ever wants to give their doctor a scare and maybe end up in an MRI machine, you can. What you can do is, don't actually do this. What you can do is, when they hit your right leg, just sort of relax and do nothing. When they hit your left leg, make a really tight fist where the doctor can't see it, and focus all your attention on that, making that tight fist. And it turns out that what happens is there's a little bit of continual inhibition coming down from your motor cortex. But when you're making that tight fist, you're focusing so much attention on contracting those muscles that the inhibition from your motor cortex doesn't come down as much. And so what happens is your right leg will have a sort of normal kick, your left leg will have a really strong kick, and the doctor will freak out that you have some motor disease because asymmetries between the two sides is one of the key things that they're looking for when they do those reflex tests. So don't actually do that, and definitely if you do, don't tell them I told you. And definitely, yeah, anyway, don't end up in an MRI machine or anything. So why we have this reflex? So the book describes this this reflex and why we have it. The reason is to sort of correct for changes, right? So if I'm holding my arm out and I'm not looking, and a cat lands on my arm, or I'm holding a cup and somebody puts some lemonade in the cup while I'm not looking, I don't want to drop the cup and break it everywhere or spill it. I want to keep my arm in the same place, and I don't want to have to involve my brain in the process because my brain is slow compared to this. And so instead, what we do is have an immediate correction for this increased tension. Yeah, any quick questions do people have about that? How the reflex works, why it's there? Okay, so back to the physics stuff from that quiz that we had at the very beginning of the semester. When you're holding something up with your arm, you can imagine the arm like a sort of lever system where the fulcrum point, the angle where it's the place where it's going to turn is at the joint. You have a force that is, so here's our joint. We have a force that's a little bit more out this way. So if that muscle contracts, it's going to cause the arm to go this way. If instead this muscle contracts, since it pulls on the back of my arm, it's going to make my arm extend. But if we just focus in on this muscle here, in this case, if I'm holding my arm like that, like in the diagram, then the only weight I have to worry about is the weight of my arm. And so we can diagram this as a situation where my muscle is pulling up on my arm some distance away from the pivot point where my joint is. The weight is at the center of mass of my arm, which is somewhere in the middle of my whole arm, pulling down. And then if the only forces we had were the tendon, the biceps tendon pulling up and the weight of my arm pulling down, then what would happen is my forearm would start spinning this way, sort of around this point right here, because I've got something that's pulling up on this side, pulling down on this side, and so in the middle is going to be a pivot point where my arm just starts spinning around like crazy, freely spinning. And so with these two forces, there's sort of a net desire to turn this direction, and so we need another downward force from our bone pushing down from our humerus bone pushing down on the ulna, in order to, which runs parallel to the radius, in order to keep my arm from spinning out of its socket. And if these forces all balance out, then nothing moves. Okay, so we've got these Golgi tendon organs, and so kind of back to this situation here for a second. So the diagram is essentially the same. The weight moves out a little bit further, which changes a little bit the way you need the forces and the way the torques add up, but we're not going to go into all of that. So if I'm holding something and it gets heavier, then I correct that and increase the tension this way. So here's my forearm. Here's the force down from the humerus. Here's the force up from my biceps tendon. And then here, somewhere out here, is the weight down. So if the weight down gets bigger, then I need to have more upward force here to compensate. But if all I do is increase these two forces and this one stays the same, then I'm going to have the same problem I described a second ago, where my arm starts spinning around out of my socket. My arm comes completely disconnected from the rest of my body and starts spinning freely like crazy, which is not something that would make me happy. And so we also need to increase this weight down to sort of keep it from spinning around like crazy. However, doing this starts to create some potential problems. So if I'm holding something and somebody piles something heavier on top of it, then my arm is going to compensate more tension, and then more weight, then I get this rapid increase in tension through that reflex, and then this automatic increase in pressure down here from my humerus to compensate. But if the weight keeps going up and up and up and up, then the tension keeps going up and up and up and up, and then this keeps going up. And eventually, for most people, even somebody like me who's not terribly buff, the maximum force that I can generate with my biceps muscle would be enough to cause my... So there's sort of this bending force that starts to develop, where I've got upward force here and downward forces here, and I could literally fracture my ulna bone with all of the force from my biceps and the counteracting force down on the two sides from the weight and my humerus. And in fact, in some conditions, under some situations, skip to that in a second, but people are capable of generating pretty substantial amounts of force with their muscles, enough to break your own bones. And so that is where, and now I'm going to cover up the drawing I just had, so you have to remember it, but it's basically what's over there. That is where our Golgi tendon organs come in. So our Golgi tendon organs do a variety of things, but one thing that they do is they connect up to an inhibitory interneuron like that. And this inhibitory interneuron itself has a very high threshold for activity, which means I need a lot of strain on my tendon organ before this fires an action potential. But when it does, it also has a very powerful inhibitory synapse. Down here. So, you know, as I'm helping my friend move and they keep piling more and more and more and more weight on top of my arms, at some point, my arms are just going to reach a point that they're straining so much that they'll all of a sudden just relax. And that all of a sudden relaxing exists to keep me from fracturing my ulna, which is the other option, right? Either I keep increasing the biceps force to keep that weight up to the point that my ulna starts to bend and fracture, or I drop my friend's TV and buy him a new TV and say, why the heck did you keep piling those boxes on top of me? Or maybe I don't buy them a TV and I just complain at them that they were trying to fracture my ulna, whatever. And so this is sort of a protective mechanism built in. And it's necessary because of kind of the forces that arrange themselves here, and the limitations that your bones have in terms of their ability to bend without breaking. Okay, so what questions do people have about that inhibitory neuron, what I mean by high threshold and very powerful? Those are two different things. High threshold means it takes a lot coming in on the Golgi tendon organ before it gets active. Very powerful means as soon as it's active, it shuts off my motor neuron. Why that's protective, anything like that. What questions do people have about this? I know a lot of you haven't had physics for like 12 years now or something. What? Yeah, sure.
In this scenario, what would it take for you to break your radius instead of your
ulna? In this scenario, I think the radius and ulna are sort of kind of connected together and function kind of like one bone in this scenario. So I think because the force down is on the ulna, but the force up is on the biceps. And so what actually might happen first before either one fractures is the radius and ulna might come apart from each other at that connection point where they are, might actually be the first thing, which by itself would be painful and damaging. In this case, actually, in other parts of your body where it's a single bone that you're connecting to, it might actually fracture. But I guess actually here, probably now that I think about it, the thing that would happen first is your radius and ulna would come apart because the force up is on the radius, the force down is on the ulna. And the weight is loaded on both, but the humerus force is down on the ulna. So yeah, I was sort of imagining them as one thing, which is the physicist approach of oversimplifying, but it turns out actually that's the mistake in this case of oversimplification because it wouldn't be fracturing. It would be, so what would happen is a two bones. So our radius up here, which is what's actually got the force up on it, that would just disconnect and become, depending on how hardly it disconnected, it might bruise or damage your skin even or something. Yeah, good question. Good point too. I oversimplified that a little bit and thought of two bones as one. Other questions about that? Okay. So for the last 7 or 8 minutes of class today, I want to kind of briefly introduce the basal ganglia. And then we'll continue on talking about that next week. Before I do that, I just want to make sure to remind everybody, your original post for blog 4 is due tomorrow. The responses are due 1 week from today, and then the recaps are going to be on 2 days later. It's a compressed schedule compared to what we've done so far, which is especially annoying, I know, because it's Carnival week and everybody's building booths and wants to relax and everything. Hopefully by now you've had enough practice with the blogs that you can do this without too much trouble. I also hope that the blogs are going to be helpful for you in working on your report, because now you've had 4 times that you've practiced writing about one paper, and then you've been discussing about 8 additional papers on top of that. But please make your best effort to not be late on the blog post, because since this is so compressed, your group members are going to be needing to respond very, very quickly to these things. The report is due on May 3rd. Don't submit it by email. There's a submission link on Blackboard. I've used these submission links on Blackboard before, and they seem to have about a 10% chance of losing your report. So please keep an electronic copy of your report, too, in case that happens to you. But the reason we're submitting on Blackboard is because, actually, we want to grade them all anonymously. And actually, one of the things that I'm going to do is, if you put your name on the report, which is fine, I'm just going to black it out before Teresa looks at it to grade it. We're just, because it's worth a lot of points. Actually, when I grade the exams too, I do them page by page. So except for the first page, I never know whose exam I'm grading anyway. But anyhow, please submit that on Blackboard, but save an electronic copy. Any questions about that stuff? Okay. So for the last 5 minutes, I kind of want to briefly introduce the basal ganglia. This is actually. Drawing from a colleague of mine who gave this lecture last year, so it's all specially patterned and stuff in the background. Not the same institutional white that I always use. So we'll be talking about the basal ganglia, the circuitry in it, and how it works and what goes wrong with it. So the outline for really tomorrow, but we'll kind of get into the first point today, is to talk about the main functions of the basal ganglia, what happens when it fails, the nuclei of the basal ganglia. So I've mentioned once or twice, so we've got our dorsal root ganglia, which are outside the spinal cord, and it's a bunch of neurons that project in. You also have your sympathetic and parasympathetic ganglia that Dr. Barth talked about. Ganglia means a collection, or ganglion means a collection of neurons that live outside the central nervous system. Ganglia is the plural, so if you have multiple collections of neurons, it would be ganglia. For a neurobiologist, nucleus rarely refers to the thing inside the cell where the DNA is hiding. Instead, a nucleus means a group of cells within the brain or spinal cord. And nuclei is, again, the plural, so multiple collections. Formal nomenclature was established after people had already named the basal ganglia, which actually makes it a terrible name because the basal ganglia are inside your brain. So some people think they should really be called the basal nuclei, but inertia and everything has sort of kept that from happening. And so we still call it the basal ganglia, even though, since it's in the central nervous system, it really should be called basal nuclei. But anyway, we'll talk about the regions, the groups of cells within the basal ganglia and how they connect. And then the circuitry within them, and then talk in particular about Parkinson's disease, as well as some research from about 6 years ago looking at the importance of inhibitory interneurons in Parkinson's disease and Parkinson's function. Okay, so in terms of the function of the basal ganglia, the function of the basal ganglia is motivation, learning, reward, and initiating and terminating movements. So the basal ganglia is often referred to as like the gatekeeper for movements. I mentioned before that when you start a movement, the basal ganglia becomes active before you initiate the movement and at the start. And then as a movement or sequence of movements, a whole dance step, a whole piano piece you know how to play, whatever, is ongoing, your basal ganglia basically shuts down and your cerebellum keeps you from messing up. So in terms of what the basal ganglia are involved in, one way to think about them is they're involved in a decision to move toward a goal. And a goal is a motivated behavior. The basal ganglia, there are areas that produce dopamine, which is involved in addiction and habit formation, as well as movement and motivation. the basal ganglia, in order to do their job, they need to take into account what you've done before and whether it's been successful or not, whether what you've done has worked or not, has led to a good outcome. And then in order to make a decision, your basal ganglia need to have some awareness of the environment, as well as the ability to select different possible motor plans. So even though it's 10:19, I'm still yammering away and I haven't told you to come up and get your exams. And so you know that it's not yet time to do that. And so you've selected to stay in your chair. In about a minute when I tell you to come down, then you'll select to come up and go get your exams. But one more thing that I just wanted to quickly mention in the last 30 seconds before I do that is, so the right here in the front of the brainstem, there are two different areas that are right next to each other that produce dopamine. One that projects to the basal ganglia, another that projects to an area called the nucleus accumbens. And they are both sort of involved in habit and reward. The projection to the nucleus accumbens is more about reward than and the basal ganglia is more about motion. But as we'll see, really especially on the last day of classes, when we talk about motivated behavior, there's a lot of crosstalk between those systems. So anyway, we'll get to that in the next couple of lectures. For now, come on down and grab your exams, and remember to finish your blog posts on time. All right, here's a close-up of proprioception. Here we are close-up with the central pattern generator. And over here is one of the earlier versions of the central pattern generator.